Thank you. So this whole talk is actually inspired by this tweet. Welcome to Haskell. We got list comprehension, optional chaining, async await, if error does not equal nil, function composition, mutable state, as answer to this post about Ruby reusing operators for the same time, for different stuff. And the difference between, in this case, Ruby and Haskell here is what those operators mean. So in Ruby, they are, so the difference is basically, is it an invented abstraction or is it a fundamental abstraction? An invented abstraction is, I tried to define what I mean by that. Invented abstraction is, well, so you can write code or interface with code only once for several concrete and slightly different objects. The object is just not meant in the object-oriented sense, but just some stuff, basically. In the Ruby case, this object is basically operator overloading. You can freely overload any operator, and they do not have to bear any resemblance to another. They just, yeah, it's a binary operator, and you can use it for whatever you want. A different, better example is, for example, a database interface. So basically define what a database needs to be able to do so you can talk to it. So for example, you need to connect it. It should also probably, this interface should also connect, contain a disconnect call, but that's not, it's beside the point. So you need to do some queries and maybe you want to execute stuff on the database. So basically an interface, and then you can implement this interface for a Postgres database or MySQL database, whatever. So this is an invented abstraction. By the way, I'm not here trying to say that one is better than the other. Invented abstractions are useful and necessary. It's just different kind of abstraction. Because a fundamental abstraction, which I will talk for the rest of the talk now, I try to define as it's trying to capture the core of an abstract idea in an interface. And often there are certain laws that you can expect to hold. So instead of trying to create a common ground between multiple concrete things, for example, multiple concrete database backends, you try to find a common ground between them. A fundamental abstraction, in like those both words are my invention. So this is not like the proper way to say that. It's just for this talk, I'm calling those two things like that. And so a fundamental abstraction is deeper. It's an abstract idea. There's not, it depends on the concrete implementation of that idea, how this looks in practice, but the idea is always the same. So let's start with the simplest idea, fundamental idea, and that is transformation. So stuff can be transformed, and I already wrote it in parentheses here. This is usually called map in programming. And if we think of map, usually we think about array.map, but it's more versatile than that. I tried to write it this in TypeScript. The problem is, you see here, I'm using this. This is a generic interface with two generic arguments, F and A. And the problem is it returns F of B. So it returns a generic, which is not something that is possible in any language that uses generics. So this is not valid TypeScript syntax. This is just to convey the idea. So you have a general interface that takes some, well, let's call it container type for now. This is not true, but for now, this is some container F and the content A. And then you can map over it. So you get a function from A to B, and then you return a container that contains Bs. And for example, for a list that contains some Ts, we can implement this functor with list and T, map from T to U, and return a list of U. So this is basically the function signature you expect. In Haskell, this looks a bit cleaner. So this F here is the same F as here. So in the example, this would be list, for example. And we take a function from A to B, and then an F of A, and return an F of B. So basically, we are mapping this function over the context. And context is a better word than container, because as we see, it does not have to be something that contains data. So for some laws. Map actually has some laws that should hold. And those are pretty straightforward. If you map the identity function over something, it should do the same as just calling the identity function. So if you have an array, for example, and do not modify any element in the array, then this is the same as just returning the original array. This makes sense. And this can also be used for something like a user would not write map identity, but through other optimizations, this might happen. And then it would allow to not go through the data structure at all, so saving you time. And the other law is that if you first go with G through the data structure and then with F, then you can also just go once through it and do both at this after another at the same time. For reference, the identity function is just a function that takes some x and returns it unchanged. And function composition is you first calculate G, and then you with the result, you calculate F. So this is basically the definitions of those two. So instead of first going once over the data structure with G and then again going, so traversing the data structure twice, we can only traverse it once. And this is also useful for optimization. So I was now saying traverse. So one of the examples, the classic example is list. Oh God, this is really slow for some reason, really small for some reason. Doesn't matter. So we can see if we map something over an empty list, this is just an empty list. This is also not valid Haskell syntax, by the way. I'm mixing Haskell and TypeScript syntax here because I think this is easier to read for people not used to Haskell. So the other cases, we have at least one element and some rest. So we apply the function to the first element and then map also over the rest using the spread syntax. And this is fairly simple. But there are also other examples I will come back later to. The interesting example is functions itself can be mapped over. That's why I said container is not really a good word. Context is much better. So we see we have some function from C to something. And just put it in the definition from earlier. So we fmap, it takes a function from A to B. Then f, this is our f now. So our f of A and f of B. And if we look at it, so if we put the A now in that space, we see, okay, we get a function from A to B and a function from C to A, and we want a function from C to B. Well, we can just plug those two together. So we go from C to A and from A to B. And this is exactly function composition. So mapping over a function is actually combining the two functions, which is not intuitive, but just looking at the types gives you that result. And this is also something that is really nice with these powerful and fundamental abstractions. Like, it does not have to be intuitive, but it works. And you can basically, if you just write a map function for an array, it makes intuitive sense. You do it for every element. But if you try this with other data types and just follow the types, for map, there's basically only one valid implementation for any functor. You will get some interesting results that you probably did not expect. So, for example, I when I learned that functor for lists for functions is composition, that was not intuitive at all. But following the types, it makes sense. So now, with the fundamental abstraction, with the simple fundamental abstraction aside, let's go to the actual to the meat. Back to that tweet. So this operator is part of the monotype class, and it's the most fundamental, most powerful abstraction we have. It's the most powerful because it can do the most things and abstract over the most idea. So it's more fundamental than mapping. And it's the idea of sequencing stuff. So you first do the one thing and then do the other thing. And I'm already saying and then, usually other languages have for some of their concepts already a and then function or just the then function, which does exactly the same thing. But it's way deeper than just for those specific constructs. The definition is like this. So we have, it's a pair of definitions. So pure takes a plain value and puts it into the context, whatever the context is. And this is then the sequencing. So if we have something in a context, and we can transform it to something in another context, we can give you that other context. And this already shows that this that the context has to be evaluated to get to this A. So this implies the sequencing here. So you first need to evaluate this context to get the A to continue here. How this evaluation looks like depends on the context. It's just like with this type signature, it forces this strong sequencing. Again, there are laws, but they are not that interesting for this type class. It's just like if you have pure and a function, you can eliminate the pure on the left side, you can eliminate the pure on the right side, and you can put your parentheses however you want. They are not that interesting. The interesting stuff is how you can use this. And for this, I need to do a quick interlude, because some of you might know async await, and it's because promises are sometimes unwieldy to use. So they added async await, so you can basically write normal that looks like normal imperative code, but it's actually promises under the hood. Haskell has something similar that's called do notation. So with this do keyword, we can basically write imperative code. If you think that this arrow is basically an equals, so x equals foo, so a call to foo, y equals bar, so a call to the function bar with the argument x. So it's like an imperative program, and then we return x and y basically two values. The interesting stuff about this do notation is this is not built, well, it is built into the language, but it's not part of the fundamentals, because this will just get translated into this sequencing. So first we do foo, and then we have a function that binds this x, so there is this x comes from, and then we call bar with this x. And again, we can have a function, oh, there's a dot missing, and return this. So this is what this gets translated to. So the fundamental idea here is just the sequencing. So this do works for everything that can be sequenced. And this is the big difference to async await. Async await only works with promises. Do notation works for everything that can be sequenced. And this is part of what makes it so powerful. Again, this is not valid Haskell syntax. I try to simplify it a bit. So going back to that tweet, we will now just go through all those examples and see how they implement the idea of sequencing. So the first thing listed here is list comprehensions. I'm not sure if everyone knows what list comprehensions are. Python, for example, has those. So a list comprehension basically looks like this. We just say we have in left on his side here some expressions, for example, I and j. And then with a pipes character, we say where does those come from? If you had a math course, this is similar how set notation works. So basically we say, okay, for every I from just one or two, we get every j from 1 to 4 and combine them. If we evaluate this, we get basically a list of 1, 1, 1, 2, 1, 3, 1, 4, then 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 2, 2, 3, 2, 4. So this is the list comprehension part. So where does the sequencing come now in? If we try to implement this type class for list, so pure takes a raw value and we have to put it into the context. Well, the only thing we can really do is put it into a single element list. Same if we have an empty list and try to do something else, just an empty list. The interesting part is now, if we have some element in the list, at least one element in the list, well, then this f, remember, returns again the context. In our case, the context is a list. So f of x returns a list of stuff, not a single element. So that's why we need to concatenate this thing and the rest of the list. So you see here, this is basically a cross product between those two numbers. And this is the same thing here. That's where this coming from. This concatenation is responsible for this. And even without this special syntax in Haskell, this is totally valid code. So this is the same list comprehension written with do notation. So using this explicit sequencing here looks exactly the same thing, does exactly the same thing. And if we translate it to just the raw sequencing, again, same thing. It's all the same thing. That's the interesting thing. Just sequencing operations on lists. So let's continue. Optional chaining. A recent feature in JavaScript, Kotlin has it too. So it's quite nice to be able to either return null or go deeper into something. And for this, we have the maybe. Maybe is basically the same as null for Haskell. And maybe it's either it's nothing, so null, or the value. So it's same thing as string can be either some valid string or null. This is the same idea. So pure, again, we take some, in this case, it would be a string, for example, and this is not null, so it's just the string. And the sequencing, so if we have null and try to do something, well, we can't do anything with null, so we just return null. If we have something, we can just apply a function to that thing. And we can then implement optional chaining ourselves. No special support from the language is needed. If we have some, this is again not valid Haskell syntax because records in Haskell work differently than in other languages. But if we have some object X and a field name, first we need to check is X not null. So this is basically we chain X to the function that accesses the element here. So y.name, we access the thing. And if you look here, if we have if X is nothing, then this will be nothing too. If there's just X, then this function will get an X. So this Y will become then the field we actually want. And this is we can do anything we want with this, just with this, again, the sequencing. And we can, again, just simply do this multiple times if you have multiple optional values. So this is, again, sequencing. Async await is also interesting because actually the implementation is very easy. So promise is something that's built into the JavaScript language. Rust has futures. I'm not sure about other languages. I'm not using them that much. So to transform a plain value to a promise, we can use the resolve function that just immediately creates a promise that immediately resolves to this X. And the sequencing is, again, this then function. I already said, like, there are some constructs that have the then function, but sequencing is deeper than that. And for async await, we have do notation. And because it works for everything that is chainable, for everything that can be sequenced, this is basically async await. But it, again, it works not only for async await, which is also why async await is a bit bad, in my opinion. It's just, it only works for promises, but it could do so much more. Yeah, I did have a slide that explained error equals nil, but it's not that interesting. It's basically the same as optional chaining, just with error messages instead of just nothing here. Function composition. This is actually not quite true. As we saw, function composition is actually transformation of functions. Sequencing of functions is a bit more interesting. And you don't need to look at the definition that clearly. The only thing is, like, again, we have some function that goes from C to whatever. And sequencing those looks a bit complicated. What this can be used for is to pass state, or no, not pass state, but pass a environment to the function without explicitly needing to pass it every time. So for example, with some nice helper functions, we can get an environment from this function monad and then do something with it. This is particularly useful, for example, if you want at the beginning of your program, you collect a bunch of environment stuff. So for example, a database connection or connection pool or something, some settings from the configuration file, and then you want to have them accessible everywhere else in the program, but you don't want to manually pass them around, then you can use, in this case, the reader monad or function monad, basically the same thing. And then just at any point, just say, okay, get me the environment, and then you can do something with it. So sequencing of functions is the same as reading global environments. And this is important, it's read-only. Mutable state is similar, but I don't want to get into, you see, the implementation of reading state, a global environment is hard enough. Writing to it is a bit harder, more. So that's why I won't go into it. But if you're interested, look at the definition. If you go on google.haskell.org and search for state, you can see the source code of the whole thing. It's a bit complicated, but it works it works. And again, with do notation, you can basically write an imperative program that writes some variables, reads some variables, modifies them, whatever. But it's still just the idea of sequencing, because if you sequence those actions, they are still deterministic. It's still doing always the same thing. That's what the magic is here. So yeah, everything can be expressed as sequencing. Most programming languages, most imperative programming languages like JavaScript, Java, basically if you write code that just does one thing, then the other, then thing, then in a for loop, do this other thing. This is, again, basically the state monad or some IO monad where you sequence actions. For example, you read to the database, you write to a file. These are sequenced actions. But instead of hard coding this abstraction, like in most languages, Haskell allows you to choose what is your context, what is the meaning of sequencing. And this is also the reason why it's sometimes called the programmable semicolon. Because in normal programming languages, a semicolon means, okay, this statement is now over, then do the next thing, and then do the next thing. But in do notation, it's actually valid syntax to put semicolons here. You don't have to. This semicolon or what this statement means depends on what context you are in. And you can choose that context. And you can, for example, there is one context that allows you to automatically parallelize IO. So if you have a bunch of requests to the database, this Haxel context can give you automatically batch them together, optimize your database requests, and then do them at once instead of one by one, improving performance. All that by just choosing a different context instead of the default context. So that's basically my talk to fundamental abstractions. Thank you.